Bristol. I teach lots of stuff, mainly African history. And my research has thus far focused on British activists interested in bringing an end to colonialism. And I've written about the anti-apartheid movement, the beginning of the anti-apartheid movement in Britain. So I know kind of, I've done a lot of research on South Africa, and I teach a unit on modern South Africa, a course on modern South Africa. I am teaching right now, in fact, we're just about this next week to go into looking at this very topic that you guys are talking, have been, I think you've been looking at for 6 weeks, is that right? Something like that? A few weeks now? Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm just going to talk about the various different elements, the various different factors that I would think one would want to take into account when exploring the history of the last decade or so of apartheid. So I'm going to start 1976 and then move forward. Well, I'm going to move forward until we get to this bit now. So I'm going to start with a very brief extract.
I wish to focus the spotlight on the process of negotiation and related issues. The key to reconciliation, peace, and a new and just dispensation. Today, I'm able to announce far-reaching decisions in this connection. The prohibition of the African National Congress, the Pan-Africanist Congress, the South African Communist Party, and a number of subsidiary organizations is being rescinded.
Okay, now, whoops, I'll leave it like that for some. Now, I'm assuming most of you, all of you, should know who that, sorry. Just hovering until you know who that is. That's obviously that was President F.W. de Klerk announcing in early 1990 that he was unbanning the African National Congress, the South African Communist Party, and a whole range of other organisations that had been made deemed illegal in the years between from really after 1960, after Sharpeville. I guess, you know, when looking at history, quite often, as an academic historian, as a historian in universities, I try to kind of pull apart these ideas that there are big historical moments when things really happen and the world turns around these major events. But I think this is one case where we could actually argue that something special happened on that day. So what I'm going to talk about really now is how we get to there, how we get to that moment with F.W. de Klerk standing up in the Parliament in Cape Town and announcing that effectively the struggle is over, the fight, the conflict between the ANC, South African Communist Party, and other liberation movements and the South African government is over. So let's first of all look at the beginning, right? Again, we could take this story back, we could take it back to 1960, the aftermath of the Sharpeville crisis. We could take it back to 1948, when the National Party comes to power and start to introduce this thing they call the apartheid. We could take it back to the 1920s, when after the First World War, the government under Herzog introduces a whole series of acts of legislation that apartheid later builds on. Or we could go back even further again, we could look back to 1910 and when South Africa is created. Or indeed to the 19th century, and the colonial period. Or you could go right the way back. Some people have talked about how apartheid really is just like the hedge that was built by Jan van Riebeck, who was the first head of the Dutch East India Company's station at Cape Town in the 1650s. And he built this hedge to build a fence in between the indigenous population and the Dutch settlers. So some are saying you can just go right back. It's just really something, you know, apartheid is something that is just embedded in the relationship between Europeans and Africans in Southern Africa. But I'm going to start a little bit more recently than that. I'm going to start in 1976 and look at the responses, first of all, to the Soweto uprising. Now, I know you've talked about this a little bit. The importance of Soweto is, of course, that after a number of years of really very little in the way of internal uprising, internal opposition to apartheid. We see suddenly in June 1976 a sudden upsurge of protest. And it's coming from essentially people like you, people your age and younger, who are walking on the streets of Johannesburg, of Soweto, and then spreads to Cape Town and other areas, campaigning against initially, the spark is the imposition of Afrikaans as a medium of teaching in schools. 50% of all education, as it was announced, was going to be in Afrikaans, in the language of the oppressor. And that's the sort of spark, but there's obviously much more to it than going on. You think that we might be squished in here, but there were schools, classrooms in South Africa, in fact, even today in South Africa, where you get 100 kids in a room this size. So it's partly to do with pressures within the system. Very quickly, though, the response is not to watch and pay attention to what these guys in schools were saying, but to send in the police, who then very quickly opened fire. The well-known image of Hector Peterson here, the guy, you've actually probably seen the other image of him, that's one of the most famous images of the 20th century, arguably. One of the first people shot and killed. So since 1976, after 1976, there is a sudden kind of return to instability, return to internal struggle and conflict in South Africa. And as a response to this, the government under a new Prime Minister, P.W. Botha, begins to start to think of ways in which they can reform apartheid, overcome these problems, by looking at ways of co-opting urban black middle classes in South Africa, legalising black trade unions, and introducing the 1983 Constitution, which you may have done to the tribunal. Okay. Well, let's just look at this for a second. That's better, sorry. So 1983 is a new constitution introduced. For the first time, there's a multiracial politics in South Africa. In the old House of Assembly, the old whites owned like the House of Commons in this country, in addition, there were two new Houses of Parliament introduced. House of Delegates for Asian representatives, mainly South Asian, and the House of Representatives for the so-called Cape Coloured population. So, apartheid is being rejigged a little bit here. There's a claim that can be made by the government that they're opening up politics to a broader range of the population. They've created this new office of state president that sits over and oversees this. But what they haven't done at all is deal with political representation for the majority of South Africans, black South Africans. In fact, actually, by this point, officially, there are no black South Africans. There are no black South Africans at all from the 1970s onwards, because there's an Act of Parliament that's brought in that removes South African citizenship and instead makes any black South African a citizen of their ethnic homeland, the Zulu or Xhosa or Tswana. And so it's only at the community level, at local political level, that there's any kind of representation for black South Africans. So this is really the core of Botha's total strategy that he brings in the early 1980s. And it's a deliberate attempt to try and sort of stem the tide, or stem the apparent tide of opposition to apartheid that comes into play with, that comes to the surface rather, with the Soweto uprising. Okay. However, the response is, as perhaps you might not be surprised, is less than happy from the mass of the people of South Africa. And we see a number of key developments. The first of all, the creation of the United Democratic Front in 1983. This is a movement, a federation of all kinds of political organisations, trade unions, churches, youth groups, community organisations. It's a whole array of what we would call civil society organisations that come together and create this front to oppose that parliament, this new parliament, new parliamentary organisation that I've just mentioned. And specifically, Coalition of Trade Unions, Civic Youth Women's Movements, Church Groups, and they adopt the Freedom Charter, so they look back to the 1950s, they look back to the Congress movement in the 1950s, and they use that same language. And they invoke a whole series of tactics, including strikes, rent boycotts, and school protests. And schools become absolute cyber struggle for South Africans in the 1980s. But this protest movement, it very quickly turns violent for a whole variety of reasons. In September 1984, the protests in order to coincide with the opening of the tricameral parliament, the new parliament, are immediately met with more violent oppression from the police. The resulting protests lead to a whole series of mass arrests. I get that in my lectures at university, don't worry. Really, don't worry about it. I just ignore it and flow on. My phone's gone off as well in the middle, so just switch them off. Okay, so mass arrests, troops sent into the townships, the army is sent in the townships for the first time. And what's interesting about that is that the army goes into the townships, but because there's conscription in South Africa at the moment, because the South African army is also involved in a civil war in Angola to the north. And so, for the first time, what you're getting is white South African young white South African guys, conscripted into the army and sent into the townships. For the first time, they've been in the townships, and they go in these armoured cars and see for the first time life in the townships. Within this struggle, hundreds are killed. It says, how clearly you can see, but this is the end of 1984, Black Christmas poster by the UDF. 200 people killed. Thousands of students out of classes, thousands of workers out of jobs, many people in detentions, rents going up. There we go. So, very quickly after the establishment of the UDF, we see again a resurgence of not just political opposition, not just strikes and protests on the streets, but violence, very quickly turns to violent oppression. And very quickly, by the mid-1980s, by 1985, 1986, what's happening is that that violence takes on a particularly vicious form in the townships themselves. And you find that increasingly there are street battles between the comrades, the supporters of the UDF, the civic groups, community-based organisations that are there to protect communities, and either the police or vigilante groups that seem to appear on the streets too in the 1980s. So we start to see a really kind of serious, violent life in the townships. The necklace, how many of you come across this necklacing, this idea of the necklace? This is a punishment for people who've seen as sellouts, as collaborators, people who were, you know, in the townships. Many of the police in townships were black South Africans. You're not talking about the police just being white guys who come from white suburbs walking with their guns. You're talking about actually people who are a struggle that's going on within the townships themselves, and sellouts, people who collaborate with the system, are punished by various means, beatings of various kinds. But the necklacing is one of the kind of most particularly brutal ways of trying to actually really create a split between the people of the townships, the people of South Africa, and the state. All this is about refusing to acknowledge the legitimacy of the state, of the government, of the local authorities. So they'll attack, they'll burn down schools, they'll burn down post offices, they'll burn down anything that is a representation of the state. And in response, the government is sending in troops to the townships, as I've already said, but also imposing harsher and harsher forms of authoritarian rule. The states of emergency imposed, first of all in 1984, and then reimposed in 1985, and then stays there until 1990. Okay, so that's what's going on in South Africa itself. An increasing situation that you could almost start to talk about as a kind of low-level civil war in certain parts. But let's look at what's happening outside South Africa now for a moment. There's also international pressure being brought to bear on South Africa. After Sharpeville in 1960, the UN votes for the first time to support some form of sanctions against South Africa. There's a voluntary arms embargo is imposed. Can't impose a voluntary arms embargo. You know what I mean. After Suezio in 1976, that voluntary arms embargo is made mandatory. But apart from that, there's very little. There's still, as you may be aware, there's still a kind of quite a significant international trade links between South Africa and the outside world, particularly with Britain and with the United States. This is the year of don't buy petrol from Esso because they have connections with South African oil companies. Don't buy food that's marked either Cape or Jaffa. You know, don't buy Jaffa oranges, don't buy Cape apples. Don't buy food that's marked in, it's in tins marked produce of many countries, because that tended to mean produce of South Africa. So it's the years of the consumer boycott, but it's also the years in which governments start to impose their own forms of sanctions on South Africa. Particularly in the aftermath of P.W. Botha's notorious Rubicon speech in 1985. Midway through 1985, Botha's political advisors and media representatives started to kind of trail to the international press that he was about to make this really important speech. It was going to be a groundbreaking speech. And in the end, he speaks before the entire world and says, "We've made these reforms, but we do not push us any further." He says, "We've gone this far, but we're going to go no further. We've made our reforms. This is what's going to happen in South Africa. No further." And the response to that was immediate. It was very quick, and it was not what Botha was thinking of. And one of the first things that happened is the American major American banks and finance houses pull their investments from South Africa, refuse to carry over any more South African loans. Now, very quickly, the South African economy is badly hit by this international disinvestment. In the United States, in 1987, the Congress brings in a comprehensive anti-apartheid bill to impose sanctions against South Africa. And although Ronald Reagan tried to veto it, the Senate were able to override the veto and bring in US sanctions against South Africa. The Commonwealth also, despite the efforts of Margaret Thatcher, who was a great supporter of actually continuing to engage with South Africa, not because she liked white South Africans, not because she was a supporter of apartheid, but because she believed very strongly that actually it was by engaging with South Africa that any change could be made. But by the end of the 1980s, that view, that notion of constructive engagement, was increasingly only kind of held by a minority. And instead, what you were getting was sanctions. So international pressures were coming to bear on South Africa quite heavily by the late 80s. There's also, as I already mentioned, that South Africa's fighting a war in Angola. And in 1987-1988, it suffers a major defeat, the river Cuito Canavale in southern Angola, where Cuban forces that were supporting the Angolan government, encircle and overrun South African positions, force the South African army into retreat down towards the Namibian border, and, so some people argue, could have pushed their way all the way to Cape Town if they wanted to. They stopped. So in other words, there's an argument here that South Africa is suffering not only defeat on the international stage, but defeat in the military stage as well. And there's an argument, in fact, that this defeat happens partly because of the anti-apartheid movement, because the South African army, the South African Defence Forces weren't able to provide air support for their guys on the ground because they couldn't get parts for their aeroplanes. I mean, I don't know how true that story is, but the point here is that South Africa is facing increasingly heavy costs in order to maintain both its internal suppressive internal opposition, but also to contain this total onslaught from the outside as well. And it's in this context that we need to then begin to think about the beginnings of the secret negotiations between the ANC and the National Party, the government, that starts to take place in the mid-1980s. The first contacts happen at actually, you know, almost right at the start of the uprising in the 80s, in 1984, when Thabo Mbeki, who later goes on to become South African president, has first contacts with South African businessmen. And South African businessmen play quite an important role because by the mid to late 80s, with American, large American banks, European banks pulling out of South Africa, businessmen start to see apartheid as working against their interests. And so they begin to try and pull out feelers to the ANC in exile. They begin to think about how are we going to work with these guys? If the change is going to come, it's the ANC that are going to be the leaders. How do we build relationships with them? And in 1985, a delegation of quite important South African businessmen go to Zambia, to Lusaka, and meet ANC representatives September 85. Followed by newspaper editors. And then, most importantly, followed by Afrikaner leaders, including Pieter de Lange. He's the head of the Broederbond. Have you come across the Broederbond? Okay, it's this organisation. It's a little bit like the Masons, but it's based on an ethnic identity. It's based on Afrikaner identity. And every single cabinet minister after 1948, every single South African prime minister, every sort of leading National Party politician is a member of the Broederbond, as are many churchmen, as are business leaders. It is really like a kind of secret society of Afrikaners. And by the late 1980s, even that group, who really effectively are the people for whom apartheid is supposed to work, are going to meet ANC leaders in Zambia. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about Mbeki now for a few minutes. He is a really interesting character in this process because he's, on the one hand, his father, Govan Mbeki, was one of the prisoners on Robben Island, sent to Robben Island at the same time as Mandela. Govan Mbeki was also a leading member of the South African Communist Party. But Mbeki very quickly reveals himself to be a rather different kind of character. And you could say that really, in a way, when he starts to meet South African businessmen in the 1980s, he kind of engages in this process of charming and disarming the Afrikaner. He meets a group of businessmen in Dakar in Senegal in 1987 and starts greeting them by saying, "Ik is an Afrikaner, I'm an Afrikaner." And he stands there smoking his pipe, taking on the air, really in many ways of an English gentleman, and wins over these businessmen. They see him as really effectively one of them. And he's at the centre of covert talks with South African security services and businessmen right the way through the 1980s. Some of those happen within 20 miles of here in Mel's Park in Somerset, just near Frome. He sits alongside leading South African businessmen, but really, really significantly with members of the security services and representatives of the security service. And through this slow process of getting to know each other, and arguably of Mbeki kind of disarming the guys he's meeting, there's connections built between the ANC and the National Party. And then finally we get to Nelson Mandela. You've probably heard of him. What's interesting though, remember, when I started here with Soweto, 76. In 1976, I stood here in a classroom full of people your age in this country and said, "Who's this guy?" I would bet that not everyone would have heard of him. In fact, you probably know, you could guess actually who they probably would have heard of. 76, who do you think? If it wasn't Beaker. Yeah, absolutely. Everyone would have heard of Beaker in 76, 77. But Mandela, not so much. Why is that? So what do we know about Mandela now? What do we know about Mandela in the 80s? Well, actually, there's a deliberate campaign launched by the ANC in 1978 to put Mandela at the forefront of their campaign to release political prisoners. 78 was his 50th birthday. And is that right?
Yeah. What the hell?
alongside that, there was a campaign brought in to kind of make him the face of the ANC, the face of the struggle. Now, of course, he was a famous, you know, he was a well-known figure back in the 50s, back in the 60s, but he'd kind of fallen out of the picture. In fact, no one knew exactly what he looked like in 1976, 77, 78. How many of you have been to the South Bank in London and seen that statue of Mandela? Anyone seen that? Yeah, you've seen it, yeah? Does it look anything like him? No, it absolutely doesn't. Because when that statue was commissioned by the GLC under Ken Livingstone back in the loony left days of the 1980s, no one knew what Mandela looked like, so it doesn't look anything like him at all. So the ANC introduced the start this campaign, but also at the same time within South Africa on Robben Island, and then once Mandela moves off Robben Island, Mandela begins a series of meetings with South African political leaders. He's playing a double game, because on the one hand, he's sticking very, very absolutely to the line that had been held right the way from the 1960s. There will be no negotiations, there will be no end to the struggle, no end to violence, unless there is an immediate end to apartheid, and there is an immediate end to the banning of the ANC. So when in 1985 P.W. Botha offers to release Mandela, if he rejected violence, he says no. I can't be free, I can't negotiate within an apartheid system. But nevertheless, at the same time, behind the scenes, he's starting to begin to make his own connections with the state. It begins a series of meetings in 86 with the Justice Minister. All right, so there's Mandela in prison in Cape Town with his own little series of communications going on with various security leaders and political leaders. There's Mbeki smoking his pipe, talking to businessmen, talking to security service people, mainly in London, well, in London and in Lusaka and Zambia, and also in Zambia, the ANC are meeting increasing numbers of, are finding themselves increasingly popular. I mean, all the roads seem to lead to Lusaka in the late 1980s. So that's what's going on outside. And then again, we need to come back to focus a little bit on the last kind of final 2 years of this process, back into South Africa. 1988 is the formation of a new political movement, a mass democratic movement, which brings together the UDF, the front that I was talking about before, and this the COSATU, which is the National Congress of Unions, and other political groups. And the mass democratic movement launches a series of really high-profile protests, including this march pictured here. I think this is a march in Durban, in fact, actually in 88. But in 89, the MDM organises a march in Cape Town, which is the biggest political protest Cape Town had ever seen. And what's significant about that is, one, it happens, and there are police shooting the guys at the front. And two, it goes off peacefully. And three, the participants come from across South Africa. It's not just ANC, it's not just UDF, but it's people from all creeds, colours, shapes and sizes are marching in the streets. So it's a very clear sense that there's a sort of popular momentum building in terms of protest. And then in 1989, P.W. Botha suffers a stroke. A stroke of luck, some might say, because it immediately brings F.W. de Klerk into, first of all, become head of the National Party, and then by the end of the year, president. And in December 1989, de Klerk meets Mandela for the first time. P.W. Botha had never met Mandela, but within months of becoming president, de Klerk does meet Mandela. And in February 1990, Mandela finally walks free. So that's the end of the story that I'm going to tell today, although it's clearly not the end of the story for apartheid. There are 4 years of tense, difficult negotiations, ethnic violence in KwaZulu-Natal, political assassinations, shootings, all kinds of strife still to come. But I think for our purposes today, I think this is not a bad place to to leave it. And this is the final image. This is kind of the whole of the presentation. This is really what I kind of wanted to finish off by showing you is, in a sense, what I would say if I was gonna be asked a question about, you know, what's the most significant, you know, what do you find is the most significant factor? I would do that terrible academic historian thing and say, well, you know, actually none. There's all this going on. But perhaps you aren't expected to do that, I don't know. But I would say you do need to take account of this interaction, the interaction between popular struggles that are going on in South Africa and the impact they're having on the state, on the international pressure as well, and see what's going on in terms of individual action, in terms of people like Mbeki, Mandela, and de Klerk, as really kind of just one part of a big picture. Okay, I'm going to stop there, but I'm more than happy to stay and just answer questions if you have any questions, or talk further if you've got anything more you'd like to talk about.
I'm going to keep you for a couple more minutes. Has anyone got any specific questions that they would like? I'm really hoping some of you do.
Sure.
What is the UDF stand for?
UDF, United Democratic Front.
What do they do? Yeah.
Well, initially they're set up as a national organisation to campaign for a boycott in the 1983 election. So this new... Hang on, let's go back to it. So you've got this the tricameral parliament, the three house parliament is set up in 1983, there are elections in 1984, and the UDF, its initial job, really, its aim, is to get as few people as possible voting in these two houses. It's a little bit like the recent police commissioner elections in this country. Yeah, well, was it 15% of the country turned up? Even fewer voted in the 1984 election. So the point was really to say we're not going to sign up. We're not going to actually kind of legitimate this new version of reform. Reform can only mean getting rid of apartheid, not changing it, not making it a little bit nicer around the edges. You know, we don't want fluffier apartheid, we want the end of apartheid. Sure, okay, look, loads of hands. You two there, and then over there, and then across here. Sure. Who? Gorbachev.
Oh my god.
You've got a
Mikhail Gorbachev. No, I'm joking. I'm playing a game. Okay, 1989. What else happens in 1989? What big event happens in 1989?
The
fall of the Berlin Wall, okay? This happens just before de Klerk makes his announcement. Yes, bear with me, you will get that, okay? I promise it makes sense. I'm playing a game with you because basically what I'm saying is you can't pin it on one individual. But if you're going to pin it on one individual, you could say Gorbachev as well as anyone. He, you know, Glasnost, Perestroika, thawing the Cold War. What does that allow de Klerk to do? It allows de Klerk to open this whole game up. One of the things that kind of supports and sustains the National Party in power is that the South Africa, the apartheid state, is a bulwark against communism. When they're fighting the war in Angola, who are they fighting against? They're fighting against the Cubans. Or, on the one hand, you can say it's the Cubans standing in for the Soviet Union, fighting South Africans, standing in for the US and Europe. So the Cold War is really kind of quite significant to this whole process. I'm not saying you can answer any questions by saying actually it's all to do with the end of the Cold War. But what I'm saying is that you can't pin these changes down on individuals or even indeed one factor. This is a really intricate and complex set of historical changes. But if it weren't for the fall of the Berlin Wall, de Klerk wouldn't have felt able to make these sweeping changes. And he's making a political calculation. He's going, okay, if we open up negotiations, if we unban the ANC, what might happen is that we can protect our, you know, for him, white Afrikaner interest influence within South Africa. He was wrong, as it turned out. But that's what the gamble that he was playing. Okay, sure. So, don't put Gorbachev down. There was a, it's a, you had a question next to there as well?
Yes.
Same question. Okay, so let's go here now and then back over there.
Why did they choose Mandela?
Why did they choose Mandela? Because he was volunteer number one. In 1952, the Defiance Campaign, which was the first national campaign against apartheid, Mandela was the first person, and again, this is all about publicity rather than being kind of, you know, as much as anything else, but he was the first person to burn his passbook and to hand himself into a police station for arrest. He was one of the most well-known, most charismatic leaders of the young generation of African politicians in the 1950s. He gave this astonishing speech at his trial in 1964 when he finished, concluded by saying, this is a struggle I'm prepared to die for, basically. So he was effectively the head of the ANC in many ways, although he wasn't actually. So he was chosen because he was really, and within Robben Island, and in Robben Island, in the community of prisoners in Robben Island, he had taken a really important leading role as well. He had brought together the Black Consciousness prisoners and the ANC prisoners. There was clearly a sense that he was a leader. So I think it's that's the reason. But more than anything else, he's a prisoner. He was probably the most well-known. You know, if people remember back to the 60s, he's probably one of the most well-known. So he fitted the bill with. That's why. Okay.
Did the coloured people and the Asian people have much to say within the politics?
Really good point. I'm skimming over that a little bit and talking about black South Africa as if it's just this blanket category. Well, of course, you know, the idea of blackness and black South Africans is something that really emerges out of BCOM, Black Consciousness. Interestingly, in the 1950s, the Congress movement, which was the kind of national opposition, were made up of four organisations: the ANC, the African National Congress, the South African Indian Congress, and the South African Coloured People's Organisation, and then this white group of white Democrats. So the actual political opposition to apartheid reflected the kind of the colour scheme of apartheid itself. By the 1980s, that's not happening. And that the UDF had leaders, Alan Boussac, who was the Reformed Church minister, was a kind of part of the coloured church. Also Desmond Tutu was a leader, but also there were key Asiatic figures, Indian, South Asian, Indian figures also involved in it. Yeah. Asiatic is the word. That's the language of apartheid. You know, the four categories is, you know, initially was native, then it became Bantu, and then it would split down into the 10 different ethnic groups, Zulu, etc., etc. And then there was white and coloured and Asiatic. That's the phrase. So yeah, but within the UDF there's people involved from all sides and white participants too, although much less influential, much less powerful. Sure.
How come within the main leaders and people who led for apartheid there's no women, and how come there are?
How are no women?
Yeah.
That's a fantastic question. There are women, there are powerful women. No, it's a really brilliant question. It forces us to confront one of the most interesting aspects of this whole story. And one of the things that a lot of South African activists found in the 1990s. You know, a lot of activists came back, went into exile, went to London, went to elsewhere, in Europe and elsewhere, and got engaged with the all kinds of progressive politics that were going on outside of supporting the anti-apartheid struggle. Part of the women's movement, interested in environmentalism, all those kind of trendy political movements of the 1970s, 1980s. They get back to South Africa, and a lot of the women who played quite important roles in exile suddenly found themselves being wives and mothers again. Answering that kind of requires you to start thinking about the kind of patriarchal nature of South African society, or at least the kind of the importance of masculinity and the macho nature of South African politics. There are, of course, women involved. Winnie Mandela is important. I mean, she's there holding Nelson Mandela's hand as he comes out of prison, and she played quite an important, although troubling, challenging role in the struggle in the townships in the 1980s. And there are other women involved too. People. Why don't we know about them? It's a really good question.
It's probably my fault.
No, it's not your fault.
No, I don't know why we don't learn about any women. We don't learn. We're going to learn a little bit about Winnie.
Yeah. There's people like Albertina Sisulu, who was the wife of Walter Sisulu. Yes, there are, but you don't know about them, and I'm struggling to come up with a name to give you. We don't know about them because they're not at that national leadership level.
It's like Tambo's wife was massively important as well. They're all really articulate, strong, interesting women, but they are all wives.
Yes, Barbara Carson, yeah, she is. But also think about someone, there are also people in South Africa who aren't part of this, you know, are part of the ANC. People like Helen Suzman, who's a Progressive Party MP, and in many ways is the only kind of voice of opposition in the South African Parliament throughout. So there are some women. There's a movement called Black Sash, which was set up in the 1950s, a women of a movement of essentially middle-class white women. But again, so there is a gender politics to, there is a women's politics, a women's struggle that goes on as well. But it's a fantastically good question, and we could go on at great length to begin to explore why that is, and what implications that has for the post-apartheid experience too, because it does have.